I'm absolutely thrilled to be able to meet you today. I've been following you on Twitter for a while. So when the opportunity came up to meet you, I wanted to make sure that I did. I sent you an email before we met to say that I'd written a post about disruptive recruitment and STEM and one of the and attracting women into tech. And one of the commentators said very, very forcefully that he thought that the lack of women in tech was fake. It was a myth. So I thought, who better to ask than you? You've got 40 years experience. You're an influencer. You're a voice, an independent thinker. So is it right? Is it correct?
That gentleman is so far off the mark. I almost think he must be working for Donald Trump.
Oh, really?
Look, I work with a lot of software teams because I'm doing design work, architecture work, object model work, and the teams are typically quite young, and they are heavily, heavily, heavily weighted to young men. And that's across Silicon Valley and the equivalent technology communities around the world. So what's happening? When I started in programming, it was about 50-50. In my own programming class, over the first couple, 3 years, the women dropped out to have children because in that era, an ambitious woman was perhaps not as marriageable as one with more modest expectations. And so it was understandable. It's not understandable now. Everybody's working. People are having, women and men are having careers of equal duration. So why aren't women rising? Why in those meetings am I not seeing? Why across our industry are we not seeing chief architects, chief technology officers? Because we are seeing some women developers. And I think there's two different things going on.
Okay,
both of which are fixable. One of them is in the environment of software development, in the environment of software engineering, a lot of the subtle aspects to the culture are very male. From the video game era, from the way in which people dress, from just the way people interact with one another, it's very male. And it's not deliberately discriminatory in any sense, because these kids don't think that way. But it is often uncomfortable for a young woman, and particularly if she's attractive. So I think that's something we can fix, and there are companies here, exhibiting here, that explicitly are working to solve those problems.
I saw a presentation yesterday by someone who's marketing a software platform to improve gender balance and gender diversity. We said before we started that I'm quite interested in the attraction, the talent attraction side. So what, just very quickly, and we'll move on to retention, what do you think are the main areas of focus to bring women into the industry, given that there's a lot of unconscious bias going
Absolutely.
On, as you say?
Well, frankly, it starts quite young, and that's the second issue, and a much tougher one. Because if we raise little girls to be pink and little boys to be blue, if we start differentiating at that age, by the time a young woman is 10, 12, 14, she's not going to show her smarts. She's not going to aspire in the same way that boys do. So we have to change the way children are raised around the world. We have to get rid of gender bias in parenting. There's a wonderful website, Mighty Girl, and I get their notifications through Facebook. They feature young women, older women, who have accomplished great things. They tell their stories. Then they include a lot of reference materials for parents, books, free courses online. So they're really trying to work on the parenting aspect of it. As a young woman, I was told that my academic options were nursing and teaching.
Okay.
Two professions that were dominated then and are dominated today by women. If girls have only seen professional women in these kinds of roles, they're not going to say, I want to be a venture capitalist. I want to aspire to be the chief technologist at Microsoft. So we have to change from the very beginning the way we raise girls and boys. That's the long-term strategy.
Yeah, that is long-term, yeah.
And that's not something employers necessarily can influence as greatly as we might like. We need public policy change. But on the recruitment side, if I'm interviewing for a position as a software engineer, and the five people who interview me are either all men, or there's some women, but it's the HR leader, it's the marketing leader, what message does that send? We need role models. I had dinner last night, I won't mention the vendor because, you know, we don't want to advertise one over another. And I sat next to the woman who is their head of all product, including technical products. I know her well. I helped place her in that firm some years ago. Well, when she's interviewing, she is a huge role model. But not every vendor firm has those kinds of role models.
Exactly.
And I think it makes a difference.
What did you think of the idea about fish where there are fish? So knowing that we can't speed up unconscious bias and that sort of development, but actually for tech companies to go into, say, middle schools and run numeracy tests or numerical reasoning tests, but not in the science and maths courses, in the soft subjects.
Look, I think anything we can do to identify talented young women where they live, and encourage them through after-school programs, through internships, and you can do internships with very young people.
Yeah, exactly.
There's the Computer Museum, if you've never been there in Silicon Valley, is phenomenal. In addition to teaching the history of computing, they have all of these educational programs, and they really do outreach into the community to reach as many young women as possible. Certainly employers could do that. Another thing employers can do is to reach into, at the university level, women who are not necessarily in math and science programs, but are in literature, in anthropology, in social sciences, many of whom have tremendous potential in software engineering, but they're going to need a bridge year. Okay,
yeah,
they're
going to
need a transitional program. In my day, there were no computer science programs, and all the large banks and insurance companies had programmer training. That went away. The presumption was you come out ready to go.
Code. Plug and play.
But there's a lot that could be done to reach out, identify good prospects, and provide transitional programs. In their sophomore year, they could start interning. In their junior year, they could be encouraged. So I think we could do a lot more on the supply side.
Yeah.
And I don't see much of that going on.
Let's move on to your favorite topic then, the retention side. So yesterday I saw a pitch from someone who was gamifying employee retention. And the words were very, I would use them masculine coded, winners, heroes.
Yep.
And I saw the gentleman today and I posed the question and he said, well, actually we're working on that now to make it more gender neutral.
But they didn't work on it first, did they?
No. So tell us what you think.
You know, people stay in jobs and in careers for a mix of reasons. And one of the issues that women face is that we traditionally have taken on childcare. We've taken on the major role in elder care. And, you know, trying to do that and a high-powered career all at the same time is very difficult. So immediately, employers could make that burden easier with, you know, flexible work schedules, flexible work environments. There's a lot that could be done in that arena. And that differs somewhat by culture because some of these European countries have phenomenal support systems, public support systems.
Yeah.
A second thing that employers can do is have a no tolerance. Absolute no tolerance. That comes from the top. So if the CEO, the senior executives of the firm have daughters, and they want those daughters to have the kinds of opportunities that their sons might have, they have to set the tone. There are, again, some companies here where that tone is clear.
Yeah.
And there is no tolerance. People have been fired for misbehaving. That's what it takes. A third thing that firms can do is train their people, expose them. There's Facebook did a wonderful job, I think it was Facebook, of actually publicizing and making available pro bono the sensitivity training program that they had developed in-house to really get at some of these more subtle signs of discrimination, of creating an unwelcoming environment. It's a phenomenal program. I hope I'm giving the right company credit. Sometimes I slip a gear. Something else that every company can do around retention. People leave because their managers are terrible.
Yeah.
And there used to be management development programs. Today we just throw somebody in, now they're a manager. We've really lost that investment, and I think we need to return to that.
So if you were identifying two or three main areas to concentrate on retaining, what would they be?
Well, I think managerial competency.
Managerial training, yeah.
I think role models.
So more women.
More women.
At the top.
And if you don't have any in your company to start with, bring in some from the outside. Bring in some from customers. Bring in some from partners. But provide your in-house young women with some people whose careers go, hey, I could do that. That looks like me. And the third thing is this flexibility. Flexibility in scheduling, flexibility in calendaring, recognizing that, you know, these women have many responsibilities outside of the office. Now, to be fair, nobody wants to discriminate in the opposite direction.
Yeah.
Okay? We don't want to have all the guys pulling night shift and only the guys having to work weekends and that sort of thing. And that does happen. And with absolute, you know, they have justification for being annoyed. Or the single people end up carrying the load because the married people have family responsibilities. That's not fair.
Yeah.
So you have to find ways to do this that balances the load and really is fair to everybody. I believe strongly that a work environment that is collegial, collaborative, where we're really helping one another, is one where both men and women thrive. And I'd like to work in places like that.
Yeah, me too. I mean, that was a very, very strong message that came out of the end of day panel discussion yesterday, with Richard Branson being asked about his legacy, was the way you build up and bring up your children.
Yep.
And that was endorsed by there was one lady on the stage from Hootsuite and Blah Blah Cars and Prezi. And that seemed to be the real message, that the legacy for today's entrepreneurs going forward is not to do what other generations have done and create a different type of environment. So what sort of environment can they create?
Again, we have some wonderful examples in our industry, and it's a good place to start. Maybe it's the combination of the human resource mindset with the technology mindset. When I walk into a new company for the first time, I can tell from the moment I enter the premises if this is a place I would want to work. You know, if they have pictures of all of the executives on the wall, is it all guys? Okay. If the first thing I see is a gamer's paradise of a break room and there's no feminine touch whatsoever, is that the place I want to work? You know, if the presumption is that we're all going to eat power bars and you know, work out at lunch when maybe I have to go home to check on my nanny at lunch.
Exactly.
The signs are very obvious if you're alert to them. And I think that by this kind of conversation, by the work that you're doing, you're really raising people's sensibilities. And that's the most important thing. Once they start noticing, these problems are correctable, absolutely correctable.
Okay. Naomi, our time is up. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Really a pleasure to hear your thoughts and to meet you. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me.